فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. We are in the biography of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. سيرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. We previously spoke about the hikmah, the wisdom that are in في رعي الأنبياء عليهم السلام للغنم. The wisdom behind why prophets were made shepherd. And we mentioned some of the benefits. We also mentioned the famous hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari من حديث المقداد ابن معدي كرب رضي الله تعالى عنه, in which the Prophet said, ما أكل أحد طعاما قط خيرا من أن يأكل من عمل يده وإن نبي الله داود عليه السلام كان يأكل من عمل يده. That the Prophet ﷺ, he said that no individual eats the food greater than what they have brought forward with their hands. ما أكل أحد, no one eats قط طعاما قط, a food greater خيرا من أن يأكل من عمل يده, for him to eat from what they have worked. وإن نبي الله داود, and نبي الله داود عليه السلام كان يأكل من عمل يده. Dawood used to eat from what his hands would put forward. Ibn Hajar brings a benefit from this particular hadith. Ibn Hajar says, فوائد الحديث, benefits in this hadith. He says, number one, فضل العمل باليد. There's a virtue in the income that you make from your own hands, what you do. وتقديم ما يباشره الشخص بنفسه على ما يباشره بغيره. What you put your hands in, and you earn with your own sweat and blood, with your own hands, is far greater than what you get through somebody else. The efforts and the hard work that you physically put in is greater than what somebody else brings about. Their hard work, somebody else's labor. Number two, الحكمة في تخصيص داود عليه السلام بالذكر. The wisdom behind why the Prophet said, وَإِنَّ نَبِيَ اللَّهِ دَاوُودِ, that نَبِيُ اللَّهِ دَاوُودِ was what? One who used to eat his own hands' effort. Why specifically داود? The reason is because داود عليه السلام لم يكن من الحاجة. There was no need for him to do that. Because he was a خليفة في الأرض. Ibrahim was a what? داود was a what? He was a governor on this earth. He was a king. But then even then he still used to work. Number three is, وَفِي أَنَّ التَّكَسُّبَ لَا يَقْدَحُ فِي التَّوَكُلِ. The third benefit that's in this hadith is that working and putting effort in and going out of your way to work and strive and make money, it does not go against tawakkul. Okay? It doesn't negate tawakkul and reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number four is, وَفِي أَنَّ ذِكْرُ الشَّيْءِ بِدَلِيلِهِ أَوْقَعُ فِي نَفْسِ سَامِعِهِ. And the fourth benefit is that mentioning something with this evidence, it settles in the heart greater than when you just merely mention something. Nabi Muhammad could have said that eating with your hands effort is great. But he gave the evidence. He said, Dawood did that. And it's a prophet that we need to follow. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go into the participation that the Prophet ﷺ participated in the battle called Harbul Fijar. Harb al-Fijar is بفتح الفاء, it's Fijar, not Fajar, not Fujar, but it's Fijar, بفتح الفاء. So you make a kasra on the fa. And it's of the wazn of Qital, Fi'al, that's how you say it. And the reason why it's called the war, the Harb al-Fijar, is because it took place in the sacred months. أشهر الحرم, and it was فجور. It was transgression. It was wrong for them to have a battle at that particular time. Our Prophet ﷺ, when he reached the age of 15, pay attention. When the Prophet reached 15 سنه, when the Prophet reached the age of 15, وقيل, some scholars they say no, it's when he reached 20 years of age. A battle took place between Quraysh and Kinana on one side, and Qais and those with Qais on one side. So we have Quraysh and Kinana on one side, and the second one we have is Qais and all the other tribes on one side. The leader of Quraysh that day was Harb ibn Umayyah. Who was it? Harb ibn Umayyah. وَكَانَ الظَّفَرُ فِي أَوَّلِ النَّهَارِ لِقَيْسٍ عَلَى قُرَيْشٍ وَكِنَانَ. In the early part of the battle, the first phase of the battle, the upper hand was with Qais. Qais was winning and he was beating Quraysh and Kinana in the first phase of the battle. And then when it reached the middle of the day, the victory went towards the side of who? It went towards the side of Quraysh and Kinana. And the Prophet ﷺ, he was present that day, alayhi salatu wasalam. But he never fought, he never fighted, he never put no gun forward, he didn't throw any weapons at nobody. But what he did that day was, he took the arrows and he gathered it for Quraysh and he would give it to them. He gathered the arrows and the weaponry that Quraysh would use, and Kinana, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would give it to them. As for he sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not physically participate in that. Then occurred a confederacy that took place, which is called Hilful Fudul. A confederacy took place, and the Prophet ﷺ participated in this confederacy. And Imam al-Suhayli in his kitab al-Rawd al-Unuf, he says, Imam al-Suhayli says, كان حلف الفضول أكرم حلف سمع به وأشرفه في العربي. The حلف الفضول was the greatest confederacy that ever took place. It was من أكرم حلف سمع به. It was the best confederacy that was ever heard of. وأشرفه في العربي, and it was the most honorable. It was the honor of Arabs, this confederacy. And it took place, this confederacy, in the month ذي القعدة في شهر حرام. After the battle of what? After the battle of Harb al-Fijar. Some scholars, they said 1 month after it, and some said no, 4 months after it. And the reason for this confederacy is as follows. There's a story to it. And رَجُلٌ مِنْ زُوَيْدٍ, a man from the people of Zuwayd. This is a famous tribe from Yemen. He came to Mecca. This man from the people of who? He's from Zuwayd. He came to where? He came to Mecca. بِبِضَاعَةٍ, he came with some merchants. He came with products. He wants to sell them. And Mecca is the what? Mecca is the hub. Mecca is the spot, and it's the place where people would come for what? To trade, to sell, to buy. فَاشْتَرَاهَا مِنْهُ الْعَاصِ بْنُ وَائِلٍ. So when he brought it to Mecca, he brought his product onto the table. Al-'As ibn Wa'il came. And Al-'As ibn Wa'il, when he came, he took the products and he refused to pay the Zubaydi man his money. He just took the product. He said, I'm not going to pay you anything. So when he did, فَاسْتَدْعَى عَلَيْهِ الزُبَيْدِي الْأَحْلَافِ. Zubaydi, who is from a tribe well known, He has covenants and has treaties with well-known tribes. The tribes that his tribe had allegiance with, and they had contracts with and treaties with, was Abdiddar and Makhzum and Jumah and Sahm, Adi ibn Ka'bin. All of these were the tribes in which he had what? He had a treaty with. So he called out to them. He said, Ya Abdiddar. He called out to Makhzum. He called out to Jubah. He called out to Sahm. And he called out to Adi ibn Ka'bin. All those tribes, he called them on. He said, look what this guy is doing to me. Aas ibn Wa'il. فَأَبَوْا أَن يُعِينُهُ فَأَبَوْا They refused أَن يُعِينُهُ to help him. And they refused to do anything for him. Over who? عَلَى الْعَاسِ بْنُ وَائِلٍ وَانْتَهَرُوا And they stopped him and said, stop shouting, be quiet, do your thing. He did, he refused to give it to you, ignore it. فَلَمَّا رَأَى الزُّبَيْدِيُّ When the Zubaydi man saw الشَّرَّ the evil that was taking place, the injustice that was taking place, صَعِدَ عَلَى جَبَلِ أَبُو قُبَيْسِ He went on a famous mountain called Jabal Abu Qubays. He went on that mountain when the sun was rising. He went there. And when he climbed there, he read lines of poetry expressing his feeling of what they are doing to him, the injustice that they're causing him. And that this is not known from the Arabs' tradition and the karam and the generosity of the Arabs. How dare they do this to him? When he read the lines of poetry and he finished his recitation of the lines of poetry, Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib. Who's Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib? Huh? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's uncle. Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib heard. And at that time, the mountain, Jabal Abu Qubays, was next to Nadi Quraysh, the assembly of Quraysh, where Quraysh would come together and talk. So he deliberately wanted to Quraysh to hear it. And so when Quraysh heard it, Fadal.
Isn't Abdul Muttalib his grandfather?
No, Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib. It's a prophet? Uncle. Jamila, I want people to pay attention. Focus. Good, you're right. But the man who heard it was Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib. He's a prophet, what?
Uncle.
Ammi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
And then he made a conference inside.
Yeah, we're going to come to it now. Allahumma barik. So the man, he climbed the mountain of Jabal Abu Qubays. He climbed it, and when he climbed it, he screamed his poetry. Quraysh can hear it. As Quraysh are listening, Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle, could not take this anymore. Couldn't accept this. He said, I can't take this. He says, Mali hada matrukun. This is not a matter that's dismissed. It's not a matter that we push to the side. It's not. فَاجْتَمَعَتْ بَنُوا هَاشِمٍ So he said, Banu Hashim, stand up. He said, we need to talk about this issue. He said, Zuhra, we need to talk. Banu Taym ibn Murrah, you need to talk. All of them, they came in a dar called Dar Abdullah ibn. Where did they meet together? Does anyone know where they met? Yeah. Whose dar did they come together and have the confederacies? Planned out, are you? Nah. No, not you. Yeah? Abdullah ibn Jad'an. They came to the dar of Abdullah ibn Jad'an. وتعاقدوا. They took a deal about this issue. What can we do about this issue? So they wrote a contract and they wrote a dealings. وتحالفوا. They made a covenant, a promise. لَيَكُونَنَّ يَدًا وَاحِدَةً مَعَ الْمَظْلُومِ عَلَى الظَّالِمِ That from this day onwards, they are all going to be one hand in helping the one who's oppressed, whoever that person is. Any individual who's oppressed. That all of us, who is all of us here? You can remember the tribes I mentioned? Banu Taym ibn Murrah, good one. Two. Banu Hashim, that's two. Ayah, three. Zuhra, three. Ayah? Huh? Kinana was not in there. Those are the three. So they all of them said, we're one hand, all of us. If anyone is oppressed, we're all going to come and we're going to take the haq back for him. حَتَّى يُرَدَّ عَلَيْهِ حَقُّ Until that person's right is given to them. And Quraysh called this حِلْفُ الْفُضُولِ The confederacy of Fudul. The reason scholars mention سُمِّيَ حِلْفُ الْفُضُولِ The reason why it was called is because The first three people who were called, لَأَنَّهُ أَوَّلَ مَنْ دُعِيَ إِلَيْهِ The first people who were called to this confederacy, who came to it, all of their names started with Al-Fadlu. The first one was what? Al-Fadlu ibn Fudala. That was the first. Second one is Al-Fadlu ibn Wada'a. And the third one was Al-Fadlu ibn Al-Harith. They were the first three that were called. So they called it Fudul because of that. And some other scholars, they called it Fudul because it was what? Because it was a hilf which had fadl in it, virtue. was an honorable confederacy, a righteous confederacy. That's why they called it. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was there that day. He was present. This filled them. Imam al-Humaydi, he narrated from Abdullah, he narrated from Muhammad wa Abdul Rahman, who were both the children of who? The children of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's son. Qala, both of them said. Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr and Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Bakr, both of them said. Qala Rasulullah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَدْ شَهِدْتُ I participated في دار عبد الله بن جدعان. That I participated in what? The house of Abdullah ibn Jud'an. Okay? حِلْفًا I was there for a confederacy that they took, that took place. لَوْ دُعِيتُ بِهِ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ If I was called to this confederacy in Islam, لَأَجَبْتُ I would have accepted it. If this confederacy, I was called to it again and I was told to come and participate in it, I, Nabiullah Muhammad, would participate in it. And Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, Ibn Hibban in his Sahih, Bisanad in Sahih, with this authentic chain, from who? Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Shahidtu hilfal, I participated in the what? Hilful mutayyibin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I participated in what? Hilful? What's hilful mutayyibin? It's the same as? Hilful fudul. It's the same. Same hilf, same confederacy. The Prophet said, I participated in it. Ma'umumati, with my uncles. Wa ana gulamun, I was a young boy that day. Fama uhibbu anna li humuran ni'am. And I, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I would not have loved, fama uhibbu anna li humuran ni'am. I would not have loved for it to be for me a red camel wa inni ankutu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I would not love for it to be for me a red camel. In other words, that day was what? It was worth every single thing for me to participate in that what? To participate in that confederacy. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Here there's a waqfa that we want to have, brothers and sisters. Which is, as you all know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the Quran down in what? Ayat which are what? Ayat which are muhkamat. Ayat which are clear. Allah says in the Quran, هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه ابتغاء الفتنة وابتغاء تأويله وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا وما يذكر إلا أولو الألباب. Allah tells us the Quran is two types. Ayat which are clear cut, and ayat which are what? Ambiguous. What did Allah praise the believers for in this particular verse? What is it that Allah praised the believers for? Allah praised subhanahu wa ta'ala the believers for, He praised them for being ones who follow the ayat which are muhkamat. The ayat which have no other interpretation except one. An ayah which is muhkam is like قوله تعالى قل هو الله أحد. Does أحد accept any other meaning except one? It's a crystal clear verse, right? But then what about if we say Allah says in the Quran إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا We have sent down. We. Does the we carry more than one? Can it be used for more than one?
Yes.
Okay. Can it also be used for something that is somebody who's speaking out of royalty?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes.
It can be, right? And then it can take both of those meanings. So it's, and each time it's restricted with whatever evidence is external evidence. It's shrah. Sometimes we can be used, it can be al-mutakallim ma'ahu ghayru, somebody who's talking and others are speaking with him. Sah? And it can also be we and a person is speaking out of what? Royalty. Al-mu'adhimu nafsa, a person who's what? Who's speaking out of royalty. It can take any of those meanings. But the believer, what would he do? When he reads, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَى what would he say, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَحْنُ we. Which one of the two meanings would he take it to? The royalty. Why would he take it to the royalty? Because قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ is there. So he brings back those verses which contain more than one meaning. He restricts its meaning with the ayat which are what? The crystal clear verses, right? Sah, brothers? We all together. Jameel. Now we find sometimes some people, what they would do is that they would leave those verses which are clear cut. And they would look for verses which are what? That are ambiguous, that are vague, that can take more than one meaning. They will take those verses and they would use that verse as though it's the what? It's the ayah which is muhkam. And Allah told us in that verse, what did He say? فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ. The people's heart has illness in it, deviation, corruption in it. What do they follow? فَيَتَّبِعُونَ. They will follow the verse which are mutashabih. More than one meaning. When they can see all these verses, they will leave it. وَلِذَلِكَ this same ayah came down on عَلَى وَفْدِ النَّجَرَان. The ayah came down on وَفْدِ النَّجَرَان. When they came to the Prophet, and they said, Muhammad, we found in your Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is three, Trinity. The Prophet said, how? They said, أَقَلُّ الْجَمْعِ ثَلَاثَ. The minimum, the plural in the Arabic, the minimum of a plural is what? Because Arabic has one, singular. It also has dual, it has mufrad, and it has a tathniya. And what's the second? A jama'ah. So what's the minimum of a jama'ah? Three. So this is أَقَلُّ الْجَمْعِ ثَلَاثَ. So then the Quran consists in it, what? Trinity, the concept of Allah being Trinity. So Muhammad, your Quran follows us. Then ayah came down, which is this verse that we're reading, هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب. This particular verse, what did it do? This particular verse came down. So we always need to realize that there are going to be people who are always going to use verses like that. Are we all together? And just because that's the case, that doesn't mean that this ayah should be taken back to the ayat which are wadih. So what do I mean by this? Okay, what I mean by this, brothers and sisters, is there's a concept in our religion known as al-wala. And what? Al-bara. Wala means what? Love, allegiance. And al-bara means what? Disassociation, hate, sah? And this is something that Islam as a religion holds. Love and hate. We love those who love Allah and His Messenger. We hate those who hate Allah and His Messenger. Sah? Bara. That's the concept of la ilaha illallah. That's when you say la ilaha illallah is wala. Sahih? Illallah is what? It's what? It's bara. You're freeing yourself. Are we all together, brothers? Sahih? This wala and this bara, your brothers, it goes down. It doesn't just refer to a disbeliever. It also goes to what? The believer. It goes towards the disbeliever. And then the believer who's pious, who's righteous, whose aqidah and his creed is sound, he's praying in the masjid, he's obedient to Allah, he's rarely doing sins, are you going to treat him like the one who sins? Is your love going to be the same for both of them? The one who's committing crimes, the one who's drinking alcohol, the one who's fornicating, the one. Are they both going to be the same? Are they the same? No, they're not the same in any way, form or shape. They're different. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he told us, oh, ثقعور الإيمان. The highest branch of Iman is what? الحبه في الله والبغضه. It's to love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake, and it's to what? It is also to hate for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the maqasid of sharia, one of the objectives that the religion of Islam holds and it has, is the issue of, are you allowed to, as a Muslim, a person who's holding on to the sunnah, can I use the story of Hilful Fudul as an argument to say that I can work with people of deviated, corrupted views? People whose beliefs is wrong and it's corrupt. Can I work with them? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, if Hilful Fudul was done again and a treaty like this took place again, could I what? The Prophet ﷺ said, I would have done it. So can somebody say, look, this shows that we can, all Muslims can work together, whether they are Sunni, Shia, whatever they may be, everyone can work together. Can we use this as an argument or can we not? No, we can't. Because the issue of people who are of deviated, corrupted beliefs, and the fact that we disassociate ourselves from them is something that you would find in the Quran, something that you find in the Sunnah, and something that you find in the ijma' of the Ummah, the consensus of the Ummah. Let's have a look over this, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, the Quran. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm reading from here right now. From whose kalam? I'm reading from Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, rahimahullah ta'ala. He has a risala called Hajr al-Mubtadi', the boycotting of the innovator, just to boycott a person who's upon innovation. Bakr Abu Zayd has a risala on it, he wrote on it. But before I go forward into the concept, there's something I want to bring to your attention, every one of you, which is a kalam. Before I bring the evidences, there's a kalam I want to bring to you guys, said by Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi, rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Shatibi, who said a very powerful statement in his Kitab al-I'tisam. Al-Imam al-Shatibi, he said, فَإِنَّ الْإِوَاءَ يُجَامِعُ التَّوْقِيرُ. Association with somebody, being with something, it brings about veneration of this person, you're honoring this person. When you're hanging around with somebody and you're chilling with them, you're honoring them, you're venerating them. You're saying that you're worth my time. You're worth the sit. This is what you're saying. وَوَجْهُ ذَلِكَ ظَاهِرٌ. Shatibi said that is clear. لِأَنَّ الْمَشْيَ إِلَيْهِ. Because you walk into that person and say, I'm going out of my way for them. I'm going to go to them. وَالتَّوْقِيرِ لَهُ. And venerating and glorifying this person. تَعْظِيمِ لَهُ. لِأَجْلِ بِدَعْتِهِ. Doing this, which is to honor him, to venerate him, to put him up. Because of his innovation, he said, وَقَدْ عَلِمْنَا. We also know أَنَّ الشَّرْعَ يَأْمُرُ بِزَجْرِهِ. That the Sharia calls us to what? For him to be rebuked and scolded. وَإِهَانَتِهِ. And to what? And for him to be also what? To be belittled. The Sharia really commanded us to what? To belittle him. To put him down. To not put him up or give him any weight. وَإِذْلَالِهِ بِمَا هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْ هَذَا. For you to walk to him means you're honoring, you're venerating. But the Sharia, what did it command us to do? Belittle him, don't give him any importance. Good. كَالضَّرْبِ وَالْقَتْلِ. Like killing him, if there is Islamic court, Islamic government, beating him, lashing him, because of the statements that he's saying about the Quran. This is how it is. فَصَارَ تَوْقِيرُ سُدُودًا عَنِ الْعَمَلِ بِشَرْعِ الْإِسْلَامِ. Honoring him, Allahu Akbar. It's a very powerful point. So, the honoring of him and venerating him has become a what? سُدُودًا عَنِ الْعَمَلِ بِشَرْعِ اللَّهِ. It's become an obstacle from implementing the Sharia, which is to belittle him. When you're honoring him, you're going against, it's an obstacle between you and implementation of the Sharia in this regard. وَإِقْبَالٍ عَلَى مَا يُضَادُهُ وَيُنَافِهِ. And it's actually that you're facing that which opposes it and negates it. وَالْإِسْلَامُ لَا يَنْهَدِمُ إِلَّا بِتَرْكِ الْعَمَلِ بِهِ. Pay attention to this. And Islam does not become destroyed, meaning a building does not collapse. Islam does not collapse except when people stop implementing it. It becomes collapsed. So these people, what are they working towards? Who would work with, for example, people who in Saw Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha or Rafida or whatnot. It's what? It's causing harm to the religion. And then look what he says, Shatibi. He says, فَإِنَّ التَّوْقِيرَ صَاحِبَ الْبِدْعَةِ. Venerating, honoring, respecting an innovator. He said, the harm that is in it, لِمَفْسَدَتَيْنِ تَعُودَانِ لِهَدْمِ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ. It goes back to two issues that cause harm to the religion. الأول, إحداهما, the first one is, إِلْتِفَاتِ الْعَامَّةِ وَالْجُهَالِ إِلَى ذَلِكَ التَّوْقِيرِ. The general mass are looking at you and the way you're honoring this innovator. And from that, فَيَعْتَقِدُونَ فِي الْمُبْتَدَعِ أَنَّهُ أَفْضَلُ النَّاسِ. They started to believe that this innovator is the best of people. وَأَنَّمَا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا عَلَيْهِ غَيْرُهُ. So they start to believe that what he's upon is what? Better than what the other people are on. فَيُؤَدِّي ذَلِكَ لِاتِّبَاعِهِ عَلَى بِدْعَتِهِ دُونَ اتِّبَاعِهِ أَهْلِ سُنَّةِ عَلَى سُنَّتِهِ. So it makes the people follow the innovator in his innovation instead of following the Ahlul Sunnah in their Sunnah. وَالثَّانِيَةِ, the second harm that it brings, is أَنَّهُ إِذَا وُقِّرَ مِنْ أَجْلِ بِدْعَتِهِ. That if you honor him and you venerate him because of his innovation that he holds, صَارَ ذَلِكَ, this then becomes الْحَادِ It becomes الْحَادِ الْمُحْرِضْ لَهُ عَلَى إِنْشَاءِ الْإِبْتِدَاعِ فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. الْمُحَرِّضْ لَهُ عَلَى إِنْشَاءِ الْإِبْتِدَاعِ فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. It becomes you're actually urging him, saying, look, what you're doing is good. Carry on your innovation. Come with more innovation. Innovate more things into the religion. You're giving him the ammunition and the mindset to come with that. وَعَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. Shatibi said, in all matters, in reality, فَتَحْيَ الْبِدْعَةِ. At the end of this, the innovation is going to live. وَتَمُوتُ السُّنَنِ, and the sunnah dies. وَهُوَ هَدْمُ الْإِسْلَامِ بِعَيْنِ. And this is destroying Islam in its reality. صحيح؟ That's what it is. Ibn Battah رحمه الله in his kitab Al-Ibana, he says something very powerful. He said, اِعْلَمُوا. No. إِخْوَانِي أَنِّي فَكَّرْتُ. Ibn Battah is saying, I thought, I pondered. What did he think about? السَّبَبُ الَّذِي أَخْرَجَ أَقْوَامُ مِنَ السُّنَّةِ. Reason, what took people out of the sunnah and it took them out of the jama'ah, وَطَرَّهُمْ إِلَى الْبِدْعَةِ, and it forced them to come with innovations, and evil things into Islam. وَفَتَحَ بَابُ الْبَلِيَّةِ Opened the doors of harm to these people, عَلَىٰ أَفِيدَتِهِمْ And also blocked from them, وَحَجَّمَ نُورَ الْحَقِّ And also blocked from them the light of the truth. And بَصِيرَتِهِمْ from their eyes. فَوَجَدْتُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ وَجْهَيْنَ I realized it was two reasons that made them fall into this. The reason why they can't see the truth for what it really is. The reason why they left the sunnah and they're not from the people of the sunnah. The reason why they're coming with innovation and they keep calling to innovation. He said, I thought about it. And he said, I realized it's because of two things. Number one, the first one is al-bahth wa tanqir, looking and researching and trying to find out. Wa kathratu su'ali, asking questions. Amma la ya'ni, that which doesn't benefit you. Asking unnecessary questions. What about if Allah wants to do this? You know how people just want to think outside the box. قِفْ حَيْثُ وَقَفَ الْقَوْمِ Stop where the previous people have stood. وَلَا يَضُرُّ عَاقِلُ جَهْلًا And those things, it doesn't harm a wise person to be ignorant about. Some things, the ignorance of it doesn't harm you really. Good. وَلَا يَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنُ فَهْمًا And if a believer understands it, it won't benefit him. They start looking for those things. Good. وَالْآخَرُ The second reason I found that these people became corrupted and harmed is because مُجَالَسَة They sat with مَنْ لَا تُؤْمَنُ فِتْنَةَ The person who it's not safe, their trials and tribulations. وَتَفْسُدُ الْقُلُوبَ بِصُحْبَتَ And sitting with them will harm the what? It will harm the people's hearts. What would he do? الشيخ العلامة بكر أبو زيد, he brought ayat from the Qur'an. I advise you, inshallah ta'ala, we are going to go through this risalah in more details. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, he talks about ayat from the Qur'an that speak about staying away from the innovators. And he mentions that he's going to get four verses. One is going to be from Surah Al-An'am, Surah Al-Nisa, Surah Al-Hud, and Surah Al-Mujadala. Four ayahs in the Qur'an, all of them show that you should not sit with an innovator. You should not. This is the Qur'an. The first one is Surah Al-An'am, ayah 68. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ الَّذِينَ يَخُوضُونَ فِي آيَاتِنَا فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ وَإِمَّا يُنْسِيَنَّكَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَلَا تَقْعُدْ بَعْدَ الذِّكْرَى مَعَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ Allah says, وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ الَّذِينَ If you see the ones, يَخُوضُونَ هُوَ indulging into our verses, فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ Turn away from those innovators. Who are indulging into the verses. Who's speaking about this matter with no knowledge. Turn away from them. فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ Turn away from them. حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِ Until they go into something other than the falsehood that they are dwelling inside. وَإِمَّا يُنْسِيَنَّكَ الشَّيْطَانُ If shaytan makes you forget this issue and makes you sit with them and accompany them, فَلَا تَقْعُدْ بَعْدَ Don't sit with these people. فَلَا تَقْعُدْ بَعْدَ الذِّكْرَ مَعَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ After the reminder has come to you, don't sit with these people. After it's been told to you, don't sit with these people. Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, what does he say? That this ayah, he brings the kalam of who? Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi brings the kalam of who? Ibn Al-Arabi, the great Maliki scholar. Where he said, وَهَذَا دَلِيلٌ That this is the evidence, عَلَىٰ أَنَّ مُجَالَسَةِ أَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ لَا تَحِلُّهُ That sitting with the sinners, the people who commit major sins, that it's not permissible. You're not allowed to sit with them. Good. Shawkani has a very powerful statement in his kitab, Fathul Qadir, on that particular verse. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Also, the second verse that he brings is Surah An-Nisa. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَقَدْ نَزَلْ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الْكِتَابِ أَنْ إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ يُكْفَرُ بِهَا وَيُسْتَهْزَأُ بِهَا فَلَا تَقْعُدُوا مَعَهُمْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِ إِنَّكُمْ إِذَا مِثْلُهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَامِعُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْكَافِرِينَ فِي جَهَنَّمَ جَمِيعًا Qurtubi in this ayah, he also mentions that فَدَلَّ بِهَادَ عَلَى وُجُوبِ اجْتِنَابِ أَصْحَابِ الْمَعَاصِي إِذَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهُ مُنْكَرٍ That this ayah is clear for what? That you stay away from the people of sins if the evil becomes clear from them. Until he says وَإِذَا ثَبَتَ تَجَنُّبُ أَصْحَابِ الْمَعَاصِي كَمَا بَيَّنَّا فَتَجَنُّبُ أَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ وَالْأَهْوَاءِ أَوْلَى If it's become clear that you have to stay away from the sinners, when it becomes clear from them the sin that they are doing, then the innovators and the people of desires is more rightful, is more sense. Because the sinner is lower than the innovator. The innovator is higher in evil. Good. Qurtubi then brings, the Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd brings the third ayah, which is, وَلَا تَرْكَنُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا فَتَمَسَّكُمُ النَّارِ وَمَا لَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مِنْ أَوْلِيَاءِ ثُمَّ لَا تُنصَرُونَ Which is in Surah Hud, ayah 33. Qurtubi says that this ayah is what? الصحيح في معنى هذه الآية the what's right in the verse of this ayah in annaha dallatun ala hijrani ahli al-kufr wal ma'asi min ahli al-bid'ah wa ghayrihim, that this ayah is clear cut an indication to boycott the kufr, al-kufr, the disbelievers, the sinners, the innovators, and other than them. فَإِنَّ صُحْبَتَهُمْ, because befriending these people is kufr, or it's a ma'asiyah. It is صُحْبَةُ لَا تَكُونُ, because companionship does not occur except from what? إِلَّا عَنْ مَوَدَّهُ, except love. وَقَالَ أَنْ طَرَفَةَ مِنُ الْعَبْدِ وَدْرِي سَيْ عَنِ الْمَرْءِ لَا تَسْأَلْ وَاسْأَلْ عَنْ قَرِينِهِ فَإِنَّ فَكُلُّ قَرِينِ بِالْمُقَارَنِ يَقْتَدِي. Don't ask about a person, but ask about who he accompanied. For verily, every individual, the person that they accompany is who they follow. The fourth evidence, which is the last, Allah says in Surah Al-Mujadala, لَا تَجِدُ قَوْمًا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ يُوَادُّونَ مَنْ حَادَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَوْ كَانُوا آبَاءَهُمْ أَوْ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ أَوْ إِخْوَانَهُمْ أَوْ عَشِيرَتَهُمْ. That you do not find a believers who believe in Allah, they believe in the Day of Judgment, they show love and allegiance to who? A people who gone against Allah and His Messenger. Even if those people are who? Your fathers, your parents, your brothers, and your close family members. Qurtubi used this ayah to say what? Qurtubi said, Istadalla Malik rahimahullah. And Imam Malik used this ayah, Min hadhihi al-ayah ala mu'adat al-qadariyah. And Imam Malik used this ayah to show hate to the people who go against the Qadr, who don't believe in the Qadr. وَتَرْكِ مُجَالَسَتِهِمْ, and not to sit with them. And then Ashhab, who is a student of Imam Malik, he said, قَالَ مَالِكُ, that Malik said, لَا تُجَالِسُ الْقَدَرِيَّةِ, don't sit with the Qadariyah, and show hate towards them. And then Imam Malik recited the ayah, لَا تَجِدُ قَوْمًا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَدُّونَ مَنْ حَادَّ اللَّهِ. If you look at the books of Kutub al-Aqidah, Kutub al-Hadith, if you look at this, some people today will say, أخي, are you boycotting a Muslim brother? Why? Look at the books of Aqidah. For example, Imam al-Bukhari is the most authentic book after the Book of Allah, right? It's the most authentic book. Let's look at the chapter in his Bukhari, chapter in his Sahih, just to see, show you that this is something that was propagated and pushed by the scholars. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, look what he said. Babu chapter. Al-Hijratu, boycotting, I'm leaving. Wa qawlu Rasulillah, in the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يحل لرجل أن يهجر أخاه فوق ثلاث, that a person should not boycott his brother for 3 days. He chaptered a chapter like that. And then he chapter another chapter, Sahih Bukhari, rahimahullah, what did he say? وَبَابُ مَا يَجُوزُ مِنَ الْهِجْرَانِ لِمَنْ عَصَى, the chapter of who is it permissible to boycott them if they sin. Another chapter, Bukhari, not one, not two, another chapter. وَبَابُ مَنْ لَمْ يُسَلِّمْ عَلَى مَنْ اِقْتَرَفَ ذَنْبًا وَمَنْ لَمْ يَرُدْ سَلَامَهُ حَتَّى تَتَبَيَّنَ تَوْبَتَهُ وَإِلَى مَتَى تَتَبَيَّنَ تَوْبَةَ الْعَاصِي. That Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, he chapter another chapter. A person you should not greet who fell into sins, and you do not respond to even if they give you salams, until he repents and his tawbah becomes clear. And when can his tawbah become clear from his sins? Bukhari says this. Abu Dawood did the same. Abu Dawood, he chaptered in his Sunan, what did he chapter? Babu mujanabatu ahli al-ahwa'i wa bughdhuhum, the chapter of hating the innovators and showing hate towards them. He chaptered another part. He called it Babu tarki salam ala ahli al-ahwa'i, leaving off saying salam alaikum to the innovators. And Imam al-Nawawi in Riyadh al-Salihin, he chaptered a whole bab in his book. What did he call it? Babu tahrim al-hajri bayna al-muslimin ila libid'atin fil mahjuri aw tadahur bil fisqi, the chapter which is prohibition of Muslims boycotting each other unless it's due to him falling into innovation or him bringing and expressing transgression, fisq. Al-Imam al-Baghawi in Sharh al-Sunnah, bab mujanabati ahl al-ahwa, going against and boycotting the innovators. الإمام المنذري in his كتاب الترغيب والترهيب, he called الترهيب بالحب الأشرار وأهل البدع لأن المرأة مع من أحب, staying away from, leaving off, loving the people of evil, the innovators, because the person is with who he loves. All of these are ulama al-sunnah. Every book aqidah that you pick up, they speak about these issues. ولذلك, what did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم tell us in advance? And Imam Muslim narrated this in his muqaddimah, that the Prophet said, سيكون في آخر أمتي, at the latest stage of my ummah, there's going to be ناس, a people, يحدثونكم, they will tell you, بما لم تسمعوا, that which you have not heard, أنتم ولا آباؤكم, you haven't heard it, nor have your fathers heard about it, فإياكم وإياهم, stay away from them and let them stay away from you guys, stay away from each other. There's going to come a people who are going to come, they're going to say things about Islam, they're going to push new concepts, you've not seen this in the Quran, you've not seen this in the Sunnah, they come in strange opinions. The Prophet clearly instructed us what to do. What did he say? فَإِيَّاكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ, you stay away from them and they'll stay away from you. Then, this is the Quran. This is the Sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ looked at his own wife Aisha. He recited the ayah, "Hu alladhi anzala alayka al-kitaba minhu ayatun muhkamatun hunna ummul kitabi wa ukhra mutashabihat." The ayah. And then the Prophet said to Aisha, "Aisha, ulaika alladhina samma Allah." These are the ones who Allah mentioned. Meaning these people who are following the ambiguous verses and they're leaving the clear-cut verses, they're the ones who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what? He mentioned to you, Aisha, ulaika alladhina samma Allah. They're the ones who Allah mentioned to you. Fahdharuhum. Aisha, be cautious of them. Aisha, be careful of these people. This is who? This is our mother Aisha. She's more knowledgeable than all of us put together here. ولذلك, if you look at the kitab by Ibn Battah rahimahullah, Ibn Battah mentions Muhammad ibn Sa'ib. Muhammad ibn Sa'ib, he was told, relax, you know, be upon the sunnah and everything. He was upon the sunnah, he was a man of the sunnah. What did he do, Muhammad ibn Sa'ib? He said, I'm going to go to the murji'ah, I'm going to listen to their doubts, and once I memorize their doubts, I'm going to come back, and what am I going to do? I'm going to respond to it one after the other. Sah? He became a member of this. He became a member of this. The man that you see today, you heard of, that killed Ali ibn Abi Talib. What's his name? Abdurrahman ibn Muljim, who killed Ali ibn Abi Talib, was a man who was previous before that. What was he upon? He was a man of the Sunnah before that. But you know who took him away? A woman he married who was a Khawarij. She was of the belief of the Khawarij. So when he married her, he married her saying that he's going to bring her from that. He married her and he said he's going to make her leave the belief of the Khawarij. Huh? And then what happened when he married her? She what? She dragged him into the belief. And he became a person who killed who? Ali ibn Abi Talib, trying to get closer to? Trying to get closer to who? ولذلك, memorize this statement. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd says this in his kitab, in his book, Hajr al-Mubtada. Memorize this. Anyone who loses al-wala'i wal-bara' for the mubtadi'a cannot have al-wala'i wal-bara' for the kuffar. Memorize that. Anyone whose belief of al-wala'i wal-bara' for the mubtadi'a dies out is a stepping stone and it won't exist, the wala' wal-bara' for the kuffar. However much they tell you they have wala' al-bara' against the kuffar. Does that make sense to you? Ijma'. I'm going to bring you the ijma' of the ummah. Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la brought an ijma' on this issue. Look what he said. Rahimahullah. Ajma' al-Sahaba wa tabi'una ala muqata'ati al-mubtadi'ah. That the Sahabas unanimously agreed. The tabi'un, they unanimously agreed. That the boycotting of the innovators. Al-Imam al-Baghawiyu, in the story of Ka'ab ibn Malik. Ka'ab ibn Malik, when he did not participate in the battle of Badr. Sorry, the battle of Tabuk. Ka'ab ibn Malik is a what? Is a noble companion. When he didn't participate in the battle of what? He did not participate in the battle of Tabuk. He didn't. What did the Prophet do? The Prophet boycotted him, alayhi salatu wasalam. The scholars use this hadith to show that anybody who does not do according to the sunnah, he's what? He's boycotted. Ka'ab ibn Malik was boycotted. And Imam al-Baghawi, in that story, he brought the ijma', he said, look at this. وَقَدْ مَضَتِ الصَّحَابَةُ وَالتَّابِعُونَ وَأَتْبَاعِهِمْ وَعُلَمَاءِ السُّنَّةِ عَلَى هَذَا مُجْمِعِينَ مُتَّفِقِينَ عَلَى مُعَادَاتِ أَهْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ وَمُهَاجَرَتِهِمْ. The Sahabas and the Tabi'een and the students of the Sahab and the Ulama of the Sunnah, all of them are unanimously agreed upon. They all came together, ala mu'adati ahli bid'ah. They're showing hate to the innovators and boycotting them, leaving them. Ibn Abdul Barr, he brings the ijma' in his Hafiz al-Hajr brings it in Fathul Bari. Even Ghazali, rahimahullah, Muhammad al-Ghazali, in Ihya' ulumuddin, he brings the ijma'. He's a tariqah to Salaf. The path of the Salaf is what? Ikhtalafat fi idhar al-bughd. They only differed on how hate should be expressed. They all agree that hate should be expressed. But it was different. How should we do it? Ma'ahli al-ma'asi with the people of sinning. Wa kullu mittafaqu. But all of them came together. Ala idhar al-bughd di dhalamat wal-mubtadi'ah. They differed upon what? The sinner. How should he be expressed hate to? But they didn't differ upon the innovator and the oppressive individuals. Wa kullu man asa ma'asiyatun muta'adiyatin ila ghayrihi. And anybody who does a sin that goes towards other people. So brothers and sisters, this mas'ala of muqata'atuh al-bid'ah, boycotting them, which is what the Qur'an and the Sunnah have shown, and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ has shown, and also it's ijma' al-ummah is mun'aqid. This is a consensus, it's not a matter of a group of people made it up. You look at Dawaween al-Sunnah, you find that. Any kitab you open right now, أصول اعتقاد أهل السنة والجماعة بأبو قاسم هبوت الله إلى الكعي الحجة في بيان المحجة بأبو قاسم التيمي. If you open شرح السنة الإمام المزني رحمه الله تعالى شرح السنة الإمام البربهاري, you open أصول السنة الإمام أحمد رحمه الله, you open إجماع written by الحرب الكرماني رحمه الله, You look at Imam al-Sabuni's Aqidu al-Salaf Ashab al-Hadith, Abu Bakr Ismaili's Kitab. You look at Imam ibn Taymiyyah's Aqidu al-Wasti. You look at Ibn Hamawiyya, Tadmuriyya. You look at the Kitab al-Aqid al-Tahawiyya. Ya akhi, ayy kitab min kutub al-Aqidah written by the ulama qarnan ba'da qarn, generation after generation, they mention these issues. It's not a mas'ala mukhtalifu fee. When a person says there is no, we should all hold hands, it's a problem. And what did you say that works towards? It works towards what? Hadmul Islam. It's to destroy Islam from its roots. To destroy Islam from its root. Inshallah, we'll conclude there bi-idhnillah al-kareem. And next week we'll speak about Khuruj al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is to the Prophet leaving tijara, trading with Khadija, sorry, with Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. We'll speak about that next Saturday bi-idhnillah al-kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong and incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.